Today we have with us Sinu Joseph. She is based at Bangalore but originally from Kerala, and she is an activist and advisor of menstrual educator for the females. She has recently authored the book Woman and Sabrimala, the Science Behind Restrictions. This book has triggered the debate on the judgment passed by Supreme Court allowing the entry of females in Sabarimala temple. Let's know from her what is the book about and what has triggered her to take up this contentious issue.
In the entire issue around Sabarimala, we have spoken about various aspects. But the one aspect that has somehow been left out is that of how entering a space like Sabarimala can have a negative impact on the gynecological health of women in the menstrual age. This is the core of understanding this subject, and yet it has hardly been discussed. My perspective comes in as a woman's health educator, as a menstrual educator, and I have also studied the temples associated with Sabarimala and how it impacts the female body differently from the way it impacts the male body. The whole aspect has been explained through Indian traditional knowledge systems such as Agama Shastra, Tantra Shastra. The sciences have been understood and explained through Ayurveda, through the knowledge of chakras. And how all of this comes together is what is represented in the book.
You said you have relied on some spiritual text and ancient text. Can you name some of them and how you have interpreted them in modern terms and in scientific terms, and how do you see all of them in conflict with the observations and findings recorded by Supreme Court on this issue?
Okay. So for the purpose of writing this book, I was guided by Sri Arvind Subramaniam Ji, who has done extensive research on Shastra tradition. So before we talk of Ayyappa, it is necessary to know that there was a temple in Sabarimala before even the historical character of Lord Ayyappa. And that dates back to the time of Shastra. Now there are the Puranas, there is Skanda Purana, there is Padma Purana, which mentions an ancient deity called Shastra, who is the son of Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu in his form as Mohini. Now, one of his incarnations was Manikantan, who later came to be known as Lord Ayyappa, and this is there in the Brahmanda Purana. When we look at these texts, we understand that when we talk of Ayyappa, we are talking of a very ancient deity of Lord Shastra. And that means to understand Sabarimala itself, we need to understand Shastra and the temples associated with Shastra. So in this entire subject, Sabarimala is not one temple in isolation. It is part of six temples which are called Shat Chakra temples.
Yeah, that's very important, and most of us even don't know about it. So please elaborate on this. Okay.
So when we say Shat Chakras, it means six chakras. What are chakras? So in Indian knowledge systems, we always understood the human body not just as the gross physical form, which is the sthula sharira, but also the subtle body, which we call as the sukshma sharira. And our sciences, whether it is Ayurveda, Nadi Vidya, Yoga, Chakras, they all deal with this fine understanding of life at the subtle level, at the level of the sukshma sharira. And chakras come in that knowledge system. So every Hindu temple is architected in such a way that it directly corresponds to the chakras in the human body.
You mean to say it is a living or organic formation which is taken into consideration before constructing a temple, Hindu temple?
Absolutely. So if we look at the texts which talk about how a Hindu temple has to be built, these texts are called the Agama Shastras. We actually have a drawing called the Vastu Purusha Mandala, where you see a human-like form, we call it the Vastu Purusha, who is lying down. And as per his body, and the chakras along his body, the temple is built. So if you have to picture it, think of a human lying down horizontally along a temple. The feet of the human being lying down is the entrance to the temple. The dhwajasthamba, the flag post, that is his genital organs. The navel, the belly region, that is the open area, the rangamantapa. And then the heart, which is the anahata chakra, is the antrala, and so on. And finally, the head is where the sanctum is. And within that, the bromeet, which is the agnya chakra, is where the idol is seated. So when you walk into a Hindu temple, you're walking into a living, breathing entity, and every part of it is consecrated. This is what sets a temple apart from all other general buildings.
And you say that Sabarimala and all other temples are on the same pattern. And once having said so, what is the effect of this kind of arrangement?
Yes. See, the important thing to understand, which somehow has been lost in the discourse, is that any of the people who traditionally know the Ayyappa rituals, they will visit the six, the Shat Chakra temples in a particular order only. So there is the first temple representing the lowest chakra, which is the Muladhara chakra. This is the Sori Muttayan temple in Tamil Nadu, Tirunelveli. So that is the place where you have to go and receive the mala. The mala dharanam should actually happen there. Then we go to the next temple, which is associated with the second chakra called the Swadhisthana chakra. This is the Achan Kovil temple in Kollam, Kerala. The third is the temple associated with Manipura chakra called Aryan Kavu, again in Kollam. Fourth is associated with Anahata chakra, Kulathupura. Fifth with Vishuddhi, Erumeli temple, and sixth, which is associated with Agnya chakra, is Sabrimala. So when we go to Sabrimala, after going through these temples in this order, what happens within the body is each of these chakras are triggered one by one.
So it's a scientific arrangement.
Yes.
You can say.
Yes.
And given a divine, say, name, and it's being followed as a practice.
Absolutely. We ask any of the traditional families associated with Ayyappa, ask the Guru Swamis, Sri Arvind Subramaniam Ji, who has helped me in this research, you ask him. They all know that this is how it is and this is the order to be followed. Now, the question is, what is the purpose of following this order? Why do we have to go like this, and why not just straight away go to Sabarimala?
That's important.
Which is what most people do. And that's where we go a little deeper into the science of spirituality. One of the saddest things is that we have separated spirituality and science. We said that they have no connection. But in the Hindu tradition, every cultural practice is very scientific in nature. When I say science, I mean that you can experience it in the human body. In Indian knowledge systems, one of the valid methods of proof is direct experience. We call it pratyaksha pramana. So there is no confusion in the Indian knowledge system that this is a valid method of reasoning. So when we look at the physical process of any spiritual progress, it has to do with conversion of the human seed into something subtler called ojas. How does that happen? By raising it higher up the chakras. So the human seed, when I say, I mean in men the sperm and in women the egg. This is the representation of the human seed in our body. The seed is found in the Muladhara. By raising this seed upwards through a certain sadhana, that is what causes the inner transformation. Why does celibacy become so important for men? In fact, the whole argument, we have gone on and on about the deity being celibate and therefore not wanting women. The understanding is simply this. Unless you are able to contain the seed, how will you transform it? So the first step to that spiritual transformation is containing the seed, which happens through
celibacy. Can you clarify on this, that the deity is will become impure and there is celibacy, all these aspects dealt comprehensively in the judgment. Can you clarify from your perspective?
Definitely. See, I think the first mistake we made is we took incomplete translations of Indian words into English. So we said brahmacharya equals celibacy, which is not true. Celibacy plus sadhana equals brahmacharya. And that sadhana is the 41-day period that Sabrimala devotees have to do. I'd like to give a story, a simple narration of what it means to be a brahmachari. Through the life of a very well-known brahmachari, Swami Vivekananda. So it so happened that one day Swami Vivekananda was giving a talk for women in another country, I think America. And there was one American woman. She was so enamored by the way Swamiji was speaking that she said, "Swamiji, I want to marry you." Now he's a brahmachari. But being who he is, he was very calm. And he said, "Okay, but what is the reason? Why do you want to marry me?" So then that lady said, "So I'll have children who are as bright and intelligent like you." So Swamiji again very calmly said, "Why take the long route? Why don't you straight away consider me as your son?" So a true brahmachari will not be disturbed by these things. They don't run away from women's presence. They are beyond such temptation. So to say that a deity who is not a human form, we are talking of a human like Swami Vivekananda, imagine this in a deity, how much more solid that deity's personality will be. It's incorrect and in fact insulting even to the deity to say that he will be discriminating in this manner.
Yes.
It's not he who will be impacted. It is the women who go there who will be impacted.
Can you be specific on this and elaborate that how the woman would be impacted once they enter that temple?
Sure. So when we talk of each of the temples and the chakras, how does it impact the human body? We need to know that. There are many Western authors who have related the chakras to specific endocrine glands in the body. For example, the Muladhara and Swadhisthana, the lower chakras, are related to the reproductive organs. And for anyone who is in the reproductive phase, especially women whose bodies are designed to procreate because of our ability to menstruate, for us, these lower chakras are very, very important. In fact, all the Devi temples that we associate with fertility are the ones that will trigger the lower chakras, the Swadhisthana and Muladhara. And that's why in olden days, women who regularly went to these temples did not have fertility issues.
Yes.
In fact, even today, I have experienced this. There is a Bhagavati temple in Kerala, Chengannur, where Devi is known to menstruate. And her menstruation is a big celebration. Women who go there, hundreds of devotees will narrate their experience of how their period problems and infertility problems were resolved by going there. That temple's chaitanyam, when we say chaitanyam, it's not energy. It's wrong to loosely say energy. Chaitanyam is the nature of the consecration there. So the chaitanyam in that temple is the kind that will trigger the Swadhisthana chakra and fix any reproductive health problems. So this is how we understand how temples impact the body. Through the chakras and from chakras, endocrine glands to the organs around it. As we go higher and higher, when we talk about the Ajna chakra, which is what Sabrimala is about, the Ajna chakra triggers the pituitary gland. And the pituitary gland plays a very important role in the reproductive process for both men and women, but in a very different way. For men, when the pituitary gland is triggered, it releases luteinizing hormones. This happens for women also. And luteinizing hormone releases testosterone into the bloodstream. Testosterone is known as a male hormone because of its qualities of increasing masculinity and improving the health of men. But if women's bodies had continuous activation of the pituitary gland and thereby continuous release of testosterone, and at the same time if the Swadhisthana and Muladhara chakra of women were not equally activated, what will happen is the pituitary is releasing, but the ovary is unable to convert it.
I think that was the reason restrictions were imposed.
Absolutely.
Keeping in view all these things and in the wisdom of all our saints.
Yes, that is true. I mean, if I have to put the whole thing in a very simple language which everyone can understand, Sabarimala is a moksha dham. You go there when you want moksha in your life, which is a release from the physical body. But the physical form of women in the menstrual age, it is all about creation of life. And these two aspects, dissolution and creation, they obviously cause problems.
So we can say that it was not a restriction, it was just an arrangement to keep them away so they are not harmed.
Absolutely. I mean, I will go a step further and saying that this restriction were protecting women's fundamental right to health. And
right.
If we take away this restriction, then we are endangering the reproductive health of women who enter Sabarimala.
And you have also narrated Article 25 has a role to play here.
Very much. Because it clearly mentions the freedom for to profess one's religion subject to public order, morality and health. It clearly states health. So if a religious practice causes a health problem, then we need to consider that very strictly. So we can't just say equality of or freedom of practice of religion for everyone, because here the health is getting affected. We have to take that perspective into consideration before we arrive at what is to be done here.
And you also say that Article 25 will determine the final status, what should be done by the court.
It should. And that is what is being talked about. But the question was always about, does Article 25 was about allowing Hindus, all Hindus, irrespective of caste or class or sect, entry into a temple. But if you see the Sabarimala case, the discrimination is not based on caste or class or sect.
Yes.
It is very specifically to women in a certain age group. And Article 25 also says subject to health.
You find that such arrangements are already in other parts of the world and there are restrictions on female.
Yes.
And you have also recorded this.
Yes.
Can you elaborate on this?
Yes. Sabarimala is not the only mala. Mala means hill basically in Malayalam, where women are not told to enter. In fact, in Sabarimala, we have this restriction of women in menstrual age. But if you look at Mount Athos in Greece, you look at Mount Omin in Japan, both these places are at an altitude of over 5,000 feet. And here, it is even female animals who are not allowed to enter. And both these places have monasteries where they have only male monks. And females of all ages are barred from entry. Now, if you look into the studies, there is enough research out there which shows that high altitude affects female fertility. And it is with this understanding that these restrictions have come. If you look at Sabarimala, it is at the height of just 1000 odd feet. But that 41 day yatra, the journey that devotees have to make, they have to climb 18 hills. One among these 18 hills is Karimala, which is at a height of 6,660 feet. And even the most ardent devotee fears climbing Karimala. A lot of legends around it. So if women went to that altitude of 6,000 odd feet, it will have an impact on their fertility, which could even result in an early menopause. So if you see the 41-day yatra as well as the temple, both have a negative impact on women's gynecological health.
And you have also recorded that the entire temple complex around all the temples, there was arrangement for the well-being of the pilgrims, and whosoever suffered was supposed to visit a particular temple and would gain his health.
Yes.
And so please tell us about that.
See, the interesting thing about Hindu temples is that they were our first health and wellness centers. And that's why the rule said that every village, every town should have a temple. And we still see that these temples, especially in South India, we see it everywhere. every village, a grama, has a grama devata. Every chakra corresponds to our anatomy, to our endocrine glands, and impacts our health. If you see the Shat Chakra temples, each of them, and especially one or two, have a direct effect on the health. The temple with associated with Swadhisthana Chakra called Achan Kovil Temple. It's a very unique temple. And there are records of many people who have been cured there by simply consuming nothing more than the Tirtham. Tirtham is the holy water after doing the Abhishekam. So in Achan Kovil, the idol is a Panchashila idol. And this idol was got by sage Parashurama from Himalayas and installed in the Achan Kovil temple. This idol itself has such medicinal properties that when you pour water on it, when you do Abhishekam with water, the Tirtham that comes has the ability to remove all kinds of venom or poison. So people who've had snake bites, people who've had venomous insect bites would go to that temple, and even today the priests are available 24/7. It is your 24/7 community health center. So anyone who is sick can ring the bell and the priest will attend to them free of cost. What they are given for treatment is a Tirtham, and there is a 100% recovery. There are many, many stories of Achan Kovil temple having healed several devotees like that.
So finally, your recording would lead us to a conclusion that it is not only traditional, but it is scientific and given a divine sanction.
Yes.
So disturbing that arrangement would bring havoc on the health of females visiting
Absolutely.
That temple and would cause damage to the society.
Absolutely. I mean, if at all we don't understand this at this point, in the coming days, we will have an unprecedented rise in menstrual and reproductive health disorders, because in our country, we have a temple in every street. And it is not healthy for women to challenge these without understanding how it affects their health. They are the ones who will suffer, nobody else.
And you have also taken note of the conflict between allopathic way of looking at the things and Ayush way or the Indian traditional way of looking at such things and problems. Can you distinguish both of them?
Honestly, there is no conflict, because science, whatever it is, whether it is indigenous or allopathy, both sciences lead to the same truth. Then what is the difference? The difference is in the depth of knowledge. Allopathy works at the level of atoms and molecules. It is the Newtonian physics, classical physics model.
So it deals with the sthul sharira.
Yes. But Ayurveda is the quantum mechanical view of living systems. It deals with the sukshma sharira. The difference is only in the depth. Just to give an example, so treatment in allopathy are drugs which work at the molecular level. So that's why we treat symptoms, because at that level we only see symptoms, we don't know the cause of the disease. But Ayurveda will treat the doshas which cause disturbance in the molecule. So thereby Ayurveda understands the causes and it can work on prevention. So the difference is only in the depth of understanding. I think there is no conflict. It is just that Ayurveda comes up to a certain stage, and then on it is allopathy that you can explain in that language too.
So do you feel that such an order by the court will go in a long way damaging the health of the females visiting, and what should be the remedy suggested for that?
I have no doubt in my mind, with my research of the last 10 years, that women who enter Sabarimala, if they are in the reproductive age, they will definitely have menstrual and reproductive health issues. It could be short term, it could be long term, it depends on how much exposure they have to that space. It is my sincere request that I may not be able to influence the court, but I do wish that the women, even those who are protesting, try to understand that it is for their own good and for their own health that this traditional restriction
and in the larger
come.
Interest of the society
absolutely,
as well, because
absolutely.
It will open a gate where people will start flocking there just for other considerations, and it will lead to a chaos in the religious arrangement as well.
That's
and
true.
Leading to bad health to 50% of the population
That's
visiting
true.
There. We think you have done a great work, and let us see how the system, the court, the government takes your work and gives a sanctity to the same. We wish you all the best in your endeavor.